We've heard it. We've seen it. We have to strain really hard to hear it. Whenever someone is ready to tell us something juicy about somebody else, no matter how softly they say it, we seem to get every word, don't we? And it's not enough that we get every word that's whispered to us. We can't wait till we get home so we can whisper it to somebody else. And so the story goes on and on. But the challenge of our lives, sisters and brothers, is that whispering is only one way that we have our attentions grasped. Sometimes whispering doesn't work. You know, when we tell our youngsters in that whispering voice in church, okay, you're in church now, so pay attention, be quiet, sit still. And no matter how many times we whisper it to them, those young bodies just have too much energy to sit there and be quiet and be still. And so finally, we get to that point where we have the mother's pinch that was perfected some centuries ago, you know? You know, just that little twist, and you knew. For my folks, it was simply the look. It was simply the look. There was one look that mom would give, and if we did anything more, we were really going to get it as soon as we got out the church door. Getting our attention, I think, is what the scriptures are all about today. God wants to get our attention. And God will go through whatever God needs to get our attention. We hear in that first reading today from the book of Kings, as a prophet is on the mountain. He wants to see God. He wants to encounter God. And he thinks that God is going to come in all this mighty mess, in this huge storm, and in this wind, and in this cloud of fire, and in this earthquake, and in all these things, God does not reveal God's self in those moments. But we come lastly to that moment where God, in the gentle breeze, reveals himself to the prophet Elijah. In the gospel, it's hardly a gentle breeze at all. In the gospel, it's on the storm in the Sea of Galilee as the disciples are tossed about on that boat. And as they're in the boat and they're afraid. And certainly at that point, Jesus has their attention as he comes to them across the water. What will it take? What does it take for God to gain our attention? What does it take for God to so have an influence in our lives that he shapes us and molds us in the way that we've already made a promise that we would go? I think, sisters and brothers, we find ourselves today like those disciples. You know, Jesus had just done this incredible miracle, fed the 5,000 plus, including the women and children. As Jesus fed that crowd last week, those disciples gathered those 12 baskets full left over. If they didn't know then that Jesus was not only a miracle worker, but was anointed by God and called forth by God, if it was too much for them, as they got in that boat, hoping to sort this all out, they encountered Jesus again in another moment. One in which is a little frightening for them. They're caught in the storm. They're caught in the boat. And they're afraid in the boat. And they'd be afraid out of the boat in the middle of that storm. And so, in some sense, Peter has nothing to lose. They're afraid. They're all afraid in the boat. If they stay in the boat, there's a good chance that boat is going to capsize. And they could all be killed anyway in the boat coming over top of them. Peter sees Jesus and says, well, I'm scared no matter what I do. So, Lord, call me. And Jesus says, okay, come. Now, I don't think Peter was counting on that. I don't think Peter was counting on it, because as frightening as it was to be in that boat, in that storm, it was still better than being in the waves. At least you could hold on a little while longer in the boat. If you were in those waves and drowned, it was all over. And Peter says to Jesus, tell me, if it's really you, tell me to come to you. And Jesus says, all right, Peter, come on. And so Peter, you know, not wanting to be made a fool of in front of the other disciples, says, okay, I'll get out the boat. And he starts walking to Jesus very confidently, very calmly. And with his eyes fixed on Jesus, he's fine. Even in the midst of the storm, even in the midst of the fear, even in the midst of all the disciples looking on, knowing that every eye is on Peter, he goes to Jesus across the water until he takes his eyes off Jesus. And he begins to sink. And he becomes even more frightened. But Jesus doesn't let him drown. Jesus says, come on, take my hand. And he leads him back to the boat to safety, to calm, peace, and quiet. In our own lives, sisters and brothers, the challenge for us is not necessarily when things are good. When things get tough, when things get frightening, when things get scary, we don't know what to do. You know, our first inclination when things get really difficult in our lives is to close down and close up and close ourselves off. When we're feeling bad, we don't want to be bothered by anyone or anything. When we're feeling hurt, you know, we want to have our own pity party. We just want to be left alone and feel bad all by ourselves. Because we know the moment we talk to somebody about what's going on, they're going to say, oh, come on, will you get over it already? Because in the end, many things are not that serious. There are some things that we need to work through and struggle through, and it takes time. But sisters and brothers, that's why we have one another. Not that we might make light of each one's difficulties, but that we might be there as strength and support to help all of us to recognize that troubles don't last always. So that we might recognize that, yes, indeed, joy does come in the morning. That we might recognize, indeed, that this is a new day that God has made, and we're called to rejoice in it, even as we go through struggles and difficulties in our lives. Because God is still God. And God is still standing there with God's hand reach out to catch us, lest we think we're going to drown, lest we think we're going to go under, lest we think we can't go on. Jesus is there, says, take my hand, and I will raise you up. And he takes Peter back into the boat, and then all the disciples say, wow, this guy really is something. He really is the Son of God. How do we come to that confession of faith? The only way that can happen, sisters and brothers, is if you and I are willing to take the risk and get out of the boat. The only way that can happen is if you and I are willing to step out on faith. If you and I are willing to reach out our hands to the Lord, not to tempt Jesus and not to push Jesus, but to have the faith of Peter and say, okay, Jesus, if it's you, then you tell me what to do. But it means when we do that with the Lord, we have to be ready to respond. I don't think Peter expected to really be called across that water. But at that point, he had very little choice, at least in light of the other disciples, in light of the profession of faith that he already made in Jesus. Peter had to step out on faith. Peter had to leave the frightening security of that boat so that he could encounter the Lord more deeply and that the Lord would then be able to lead him to safety. Sisters and brothers, today you and I are faced with all kinds of turmoil, all kinds of struggle, all kinds of storms in our lives. Some of those pass rather quickly. Others we have to deal with and carry and are burdened with for some time. And if we're not careful, sisters and brothers, we can shut down. We can close ourselves off. We can want to be left alone. And we'll find ourselves sitting in that boat, still being tossed about, because we refuse to look outside of ourselves and see the face of God and our brothers and sisters who want to help. we can miss the face of God coming to us in opportunities and situations and occasions that can move us beyond our grief and our doubt and our loss and our struggle. But we have to be willing to look through the storm to see Jesus and to believe that it really is Jesus who calls us out of our fear, who calls us out of our isolation, who calls us out of danger into the hope or promise of new life. This gospel is Jesus is walking on the water. It says that it is in the fourth watch of the night. Now, fourth watch of the night is that last part of the night. And anyone who has been up all night for one reason or another, for good or for bad, in anticipation of something or struggling to get a project done to meet a deadline, when you're up all night, by about 4 in the morning, your mind starts playing tricks on you. You start getting silly. All kinds of things begin to take over our thinking, and we look out and we're not sure if we see things or don't see things, and we realize that we are weary and crazy for lack of sleep. It's in that situation that Jesus appears to the disciples. And so they're not really sure. They're not really sure if it's really the Lord or is it some deception? Is it a ghost? Is it something that's being made up in their mind? Sisters and brothers, it's when we find ourselves most in those confusing kinds of moments that the Lord wants to come to us and to call us across the tumultuous challenges of our lives and to let us know that He will lead us and He will protect us and He will raise us up and will not let us down. All we have to do is keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. Keep our gaze fixed on the Lord. Keep looking to what God not only asks of us, but looking for what God has in store for us. To be able to see beyond our current situation, our current challenges, our current struggles, to recognize that God has something in store for us yet. We know it's in the time of tragedy. We know it's in the time of uncertainty that while we might be tempted to close ourselves off, it is also that time when we most come together. Families in times of loss, a nation in times of crisis, a world aware of the struggles that are going on in illness and political strife, and domination and disrespect of human persons. It's when we find ourselves dealing with those hard realities of our life that we can come together and most profoundly reflect the grace and mercy and love of our God. Today, sisters and brothers, we're being invited by the Lord. Even though we're being tossed about by many struggles and many storms in our lives and in the world around us, we're being asked to trust, to get out of the boat, to follow after the Lord Jesus, and to trust that He's not going to let us down, literally. But Jesus will always be there to raise us up. All we need to do is stretch out and reach for God's hand. The prophet Elijah, over and over again, was confronted with the challenges of the world around him and false prophets and all those struggles. And every time Elijah turned again to the Lord, every time Elijah turned again to see what God would ask of him next in the midst of those struggles and difficulties. Even Paul, in his preaching, we hear in that second reading today how Paul is struggling, is being called a liar. It is being called a false prophet because he who was once a persecutor of Christians, now a follower and preacher of Jesus, only because Paul reached out and touched the Lord's hand. Only because Paul allowed himself to be focused again and renewed in facing the Lord Jesus. Only by that was he able to move from an old way of being to a new way of being. Only by this encounter of Jesus with the disciples in the boat were they able to move from an old way of being, an old way of fear, to really coming to that group profession that indeed Jesus was the Son of God. Today, let's get on the boat. Today, let's step out on faith. Let's leave behind all those struggles and pains that we have. Doesn't mean that they're not going to be there, but it does mean today we make a commitment that they're not going to control our lives. Fear is not going to control our life. Gossip is not going to control our life. Illness is not going to control our life. We're going to step out on faith and put our hands in the hand of the Lord and say, Lord, if it's you, call me to come to you and help me to stay fixed on you through the illness, through the storm, through the struggle, through the pain, so that we might come to that joy that is promised in the morning. Along the way, we get weary, we get tired, we get hungry, we get worn out. But we come here this morning to receive from the Lord a nourishment that only He can give. Today, the Lord is reaching out His hands to us. And we might even say, Lord, if it's you, tell me to come to you down this aisle. If it's you, tell me to come to you at this altar. And trust and believe that Jesus' words to us are indeed, come. Come to me. Across the storms of your life. Come to me across the struggles and the pain. Come to me, and I will give you rest. I will give you what you need. I will raise you up. I will guide you and keep you and hold you in the palm of my hand. Today, sisters and brothers, may we heed the invitation of the Lord and not be afraid. Whether Jesus comes to us in the midst of the storm across the sea of our life, to us in the quiet calm of a whisper in our hearts. May we today be ready to hear the Lord and respond to His call to come after Him. Amen.